Alcaeus of Mytilene. Alcaeus of Mytilene, Alcaios of Mytilene, 6th century BC, was a lyric poet from the Greek island of Lesbos who is credited with inventing the Alcaic stanza. He was included in the canonical list of 9 lyric poets by the scholars of Hellenistic Alexandria. He was an older contemporary and an alleged lover of Sappho, with whom he may have exchanged poems. He was born into the aristocratic governing class of Mytilene, the main city of Lesbos, where he was involved in political disputes and feuds. The broad outlines of the poet's life are well known. He was born into the aristocratic, warrior class that dominated Mytilene, the strongest city-state on the island of Lesbos and, by the end of the 7th century BC, the most influential of all the North Aegean Greek cities, with a strong navy and colonies securing its trade routes in the Hellespont. The city had long been ruled by kings born to the Penthilid clan but, during the poet's life, the Penthilids were a spent force and rival aristocrats and their factions contended with each other for supreme power. Alcaeus and his older brothers were passionately involved in the struggle but experienced little success. Their political adventures can be understood in terms of 3 tyrants who came and went in succession. Sometime before 600 BC, Mytilene fought Athens for control of Sigean and Alcaeus was old enough to participate in the fighting. According to the historian Herodotus, the poet threw away his shield to make good his escape from the victorious Athenians, then celebrated the occasion in a poem that he later sent to his friend, Melanippus. It is thought that Alcaeus traveled widely during his years in exile, including at least one visit to Egypt. His older brother, Antimenides, appears to have served as a mercenary in the army of Nebuchadnezzar II and probably took part in the conquest of Ascalon. Alcaeus wrote verses in celebration of Antimenides' return, including mention of his valor in slaying the larger opponent, Frag.350, and he proudly describes the military hardware that adorned their family home, Frag.357. Alcaeus was a contemporary and a countryman of Sappho and, since both poets composed for the entertainment of Mytilenean friends, they had many opportunities to associate with each other on a quite regular basis, such as at the Callistia, an annual festival celebrating the island's federation under Mytilene, held at the Messon, referred to as Temenos in FRS 129 and 130, where Sappho performed publicly with female choirs. Alcaeus referenced to Sappho in terms more typical of a divinity, as holy/pure, honey-smiling Sappho, Father 384, may owe its inspiration to her performance at the festival. The Lesbian Oriolic school of poetry reached in the songs of Sappho and Alcaeus that high point of brilliancy to which it never afterwards approached, and it was assumed by later Greek critics and during the early centuries of the Christian era that the two poets were in fact lovers, a theme which became a favorite subject in art, as in the urn pictured above. The poetic works of Alcaeus were collected into 10 books, with elaborate commentaries, by the Alexandrian scholars Aristophanes of Byzantium and Aristarchus of Samothrace sometime in the 3rd century BC, and yet his verses today exist only in fragmentary form, varying in size from mere phrases, such as wine, window into a man, Father 333, to entire groups of verses and stanzas, such as those quoted below, Father 346. Alexandrian scholars numbered him in their canonic 9, 1 lyric poet per muse. Among these, Pindar was held by many ancient critics to be preeminent, but some gave precedence to Alcaeus instead. The canonic 9 are traditionally divided into 2 groups, with Alcaeus, Sappho, and Anacreon, being monodists or solo singers, with the following characteristics. The other 6 of the canonic 9 composed verses for public occasions, performed by choruses and professional singers and typically featuring complex metrical arrangements that were never reproduced in other verses. However, this division into 2 groups is considered by some modern scholars to be too simplistic, and often it is practically impossible to know whether a lyric composition was sung or recited, or whether or not it was accompanied by musical instruments and dance. Even the private reflections of Alcaeus, ostensibly sung at dinner parties, still retain a public function. Critics often seek to understand Alcaeus in comparison with Sappho. The Roman poet, Horace, also compared the two, describing Alcaeus as more full-throatedly singing, see Horace's tribute below. Alcaeus himself seems to underscore the difference between his own down-to-earth style and Sappho's more celestial qualities when he describes her almost as a goddess, as cited above, and yet it has been argued that both poets were concerned with a balance between the divine and the profane, each emphasizing different elements in that balance. Dionysius of Halicarnassus exhorts us to observe in Alcaeus the sublimity, brevity and sweetness coupled with stern power, his splendid figures, and his clearness which was unimpaired by the dialect, and above all mark his manner of expressing his sentiments on public affairs, while Quintilian, after commending Alcaeus for his excellence in that part of his works where he inveighs against tyrants and contributes to good morals, in his language haste concise, exalted, careful and often like an orator, goes on to add, but he descended into wantonness and amours, though better fitted for higher things. The works of Alcaeus are conventionally grouped according to five genres. The following verses demonstrate some key characteristics of the Alcaic style. Square brackets indicate uncertainties in the ancient text. The Greek meter here is relatively simple, comprising the greater asylpiad, adroitly used to convey, for example, the rhythm of jostling cups. The language of the poem is typically direct and concise and comprises short sentences. The first line is in fact a model of condensed meaning, comprising an exhortation, let's drink, a rhetorical question, why are we waiting for the lamps? And a justifying statement, only an inch of daylight left. The meaning is clear and uncomplicated, the subject is drawn from personal experience, and there is an absence of poetic ornament, such as simile or metaphor. Like many of his poems, for example, FRS 38, 326, 338, 347, 350, it begins with a verb, in this case let's drink, and it includes a proverbial expression, only an inch of daylight left, though it is possible that he coined it himself. Alcaeus rarely used metaphor or simile, and yet he had a fondness for the allegory of the storm-tossed ship of state. The following fragment of a hymn to Castor and Polydeuces, the Dioscuri, is possibly another example of this, though some scholars interpret it instead as a prayer for a safe voyage. Poem style equals margin left colon 2 m greater than hither now to me from your Isle of Pelops, you powerful children of Zeus and Leda, showing yourselves kindly by nature, Castor and Polydeuces. Traveling abroad on swift-footed horses, over the wide earth, over all the ocean, how easily you bring deliverance from death's gelid rigor. Landing on tall ships with a sudden, great bound, a faraway light up the forestays running, bringing radiance to a ship in trouble, sailed in the darkness. Poem. The poem was written in Sapphic stanzas, a verse form popularly associated with his compatriot, Sappho, but in which he too excelled, here paraphrased in English to suggest the same rhythms. There were probably another three stanzas in the original poem, but only nine letters of them remained. The faraway light is a reference to St. Elmo's fire, an electrical discharge supposed by ancient Greek mariners to be an epiphany of the Dioscuri, but the meaning of the line was obscured by gaps in the papyrus until reconstructed by a modern scholar. Such reconstructions are typical of the extant poetry. See scholars, fragments and sources below. This poem doesn't begin with a verb but with an adverb, delta epsilon upsilon tau, but still communicates a sense of action. He probably performed his verses at drinking parties for friends and political allies, men for whom loyalty was essential, particularly in such troubled times. The Roman poet Horace modeled his own lyrical compositions on those of Alcaeus, rendering the Lesbian poet's verse forms, including Alcaic and Sapphic stanzas, into concise Latin, an achievement he celebrates in his third book of odes. In his second book, in an ode composed in Alcaic stanzas on the subject of an almost fatal accident he had on his farm, he imagines meeting Alcaeus and Sappho in Hades. Ovid compared Alcaeus to Sappho in Letters of the Heroines, where Sappho is imagined to speak as follows. The story of Alcaeus is partly the story of the scholars who rescued his work from oblivion. His verses have not come down to us through a manuscript tradition, generations of scribes copying an author's collected works, such as delivered intact into the modern age four entire books of Pindar's odes, but haphazardly, in quotes from ancient scholars and commentators whose own works have chanced to survive, and in the tattered remnants of papyri uncovered from an ancient rubbish pile at Oxyrhynchus and other locations in Egypt, sources that modern scholars have studied and correlated exhaustively, adding little by little to the world's store of poetic fragments. Ancient scholars quoted Alcaeus in support of various arguments. Thus, for example, Heraclitus the Allegorist quoted Fr.326 and part of Father 6, about ships in a storm, in his study on Homer's use of allegory. The hymn to Hermes, Fr.308b, was quoted by Hephaestion, Grammarian, and both he and Libanius, the rhetorician, quoted the first two lines of Father 350, celebrating the return from Babylon of Alcaeus' brother. The rest of Father 350 was paraphrased in prose by the historian/geographer Strabo. Many fragments were supplied in quotes by Athenaeus, principally on the subject of wine drinking, but Father 333, wine, window into a man, was quoted much later by the Byzantine grammarian, John Tzetzes. The first modern publication of Alcaeus verses appeared in a Greek and Latin edition of fragments collected from the canonic nine lyrical poets by Michael Neander, published at Bâle in 1556. This was followed by another edition of the nine poets, collected by Henricus Stephanus and published in Paris in 1560. Fulvius Ursinus compiled a fuller collection of Alcaic fragments, including a commentary, which was published at Antwerp in 1568. The first separate edition of Alcaeus was by Christian David Johnny and it was published at Halle in 1780. The next separate edition was by August Mathai, Leipzig 1827. Some of the fragments quoted by ancient scholars were able to be integrated by scholars in the 19th century. Thus, for example, two separate quotes by Athenaeus were united by Theodor Berg to form Father 362. Three separate sources were combined to form Fr.350, as mentioned above, including a prose paraphrase from Strabo that first needed to be restored to its original meter, a synthesis achieved by the united efforts of Otto Hoffmann, Karl Ottfried Müller, and Franz Heinrich Ludolf Ahrens. The discovery of the Oxyrhynchus papyri towards the end of the 19th century dramatically increased the scope of scholarly research. In fact, eight important fragments have now been compiled from papyri, FRS.9. 38a, 42, 45, 34, 129, 130 and most recently S262. These fragments typically feature lacunae or gaps that scholars fill with educated guesses, including for example a brilliant supplement by Maurice Bora in Father 34, a hymn to the Dioscuri that includes a description of St. Elmo's fire in the ship's rigging. Working with only eight letters, TR. Pro, TR, NS. Bohr conjured up a phrase that brilliantly develops the meaning in the euphony of the poem, TR. Proton entre condes, describing luminescence running along the force tays. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.